Ladies and gentlemen, does this look like the kind of beach that you would want to visit for a holiday? Me neither. However, I do know some people who did visit this beach, but they didn't go for a holiday. They went to do a cleanup. As you can imagine, they had quite a lot to clean up. In less than 3 hours on this stretch of beach, they had collected 5 tons of mostly plastic waste. 5 tons. Let me put that into context for you. 5 tons of plastic waste, which looks a lot like this, is the same as a fully grown African elephant. And if you've ever seen one, you know that they're really big. On the plus side, once they moved all that plastic away, the beach looked like this. And I don't know about you, but that's definitely the kind of beach that I would want to visit for a holiday. The sad thing, though, is that the plastic keeps coming back. There is so much of it in the water that no matter how many cleanups we do, how many hours we spend cleaning the beach, and how many tons of plastic we clear up, the beach doesn't look like this for very long. But if we want the beach to keep looking like this, there are many things we can do. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Elahe Anjarwalla, and I'm here today to talk to you about this plastic problem. First, I want to tell you about how plastic was invented, then the damage that it's caused, and why it's actually a problem. Before, we'll look at some of the solutions. And in particular, there are 3 things I want to tell you about. The first is a very special boat named the Flipflopi. The second is a plastic revolution. And finally, some of the things that you can do to be part of this journey. So, let's start at the very beginning. Plastic was invented by this gentleman, a fellow named Leo Baekeland. He was a Belgian-American, and in 1907, he invented a hard, moldable substance, which he named Bakelite. Bakelite was an exciting invention for several reasons. First, it was fully synthetic, and it was derived from fossil fuels. It also had several abilities that made it very exciting. First was the fact that it could be molded quickly, allowing for mass production. This made it not only a chemical success, but a commercial success, which is very important to any business. Some of the features that made it very exciting are the fact that it's resistant to electricity, to scratches, it has low conductivity, it's very durable, very versatile, and not so flexible, which meant that it had many different applications. And interestingly enough, in 1993, it was recognized as a National Chemical Historic Landmark because of the fact that it was the first truly synthetic plastic in the world, and it heralded the age of plastics. So basically, this invention changed our world as we know it. Does anyone in this room study chemistry, or has studied chemistry in the past? Okay, so my chemists, this is for you. This is the chemical name of Bakelite. It's 36 letters long, and I'm going to take a stab at saying it. Polyoxybenzylmethyl-N-glycolanhydride. Try say that several times in a row and you have a real tongue twister. Even though it's a long word, in short, this invention revolutionized the way we live. And it's had significant impact on our lives, both positive and negative. And since then, we've had plastic invented in several different shapes and forms. And nowadays, plastic is everywhere, including, as you can see, this random assortment of objects from my household, and I'm sure in many of your households too. The problem is that when Leo Baekeland invented Bakelite, and all subsequent inventions were discovered afterwards, they didn't realize just what damage it would cause. So for example, Leo Baekeland knew that plastic was very durable, but I don't think even he knew how durable it was. We now know that plastic doesn't really decompose. It just breaks down into smaller and smaller and smaller pieces, ultimately ending up in the systems of animals and then in humans as it goes up the food chain. Obviously, this isn't very good for our health if you eat plastic. However, it's also not good for our health when it's hanging out in the environment, because plastic is known to leach toxins and chemicals. Some of these are suspected to cause cancer. Others are known to have a significant impact on our nervous system, our hormones, etc. So they really impact how our body functions. Some of the plastic that causes this damage are the 500 billion plastic bags that are used annually worldwide. 500 billion. I still haven't fully wrapped my head around that number because there are so many zeros in it. And the worst part is that it's estimated that less than 5% of those plastic bags are recycled. Many of those plastic bags end up being part of the 8 million tons of waste that end up in our oceans annually, killing approximately 1 million seabirds and about 100,000 marine mammals. And these are just estimates. What's worse is that if we keep on heading down this path, by 2050, there will be more plastic than fish in the sea. Can you imagine going snorkeling and seeing only a plastic bag floating in front of you or a water bottle and not seeing any colorful fish? I think that would be really sad. And that's why I'm going to stop with the statistics, because they don't get any better. And in fact, they just get worse. But if there's one thing I've learned, talking about your problems in life doesn't get you very far. And I want to be focused on the solutions, which I hope you will be too. So first, let me introduce you to the special boat I mentioned, named the Flipflopi. If you've ever been anywhere on the East African coast, you've probably seen something that looks like this. An idyllic setting with turquoise blue waters, stunning white sand beaches, and an elegant boat. This boat is called a dhow, and this one is a very small one. This dhow is much, much bigger, as you can tell by the size of the people in the photo. The Flipflopi is going to be a replica of this boat, but it will be built out of 100% recycled plastic. And we're then going to sail it all the way from Lamu to the beautiful city of Cape Town in South Africa, which is a journey of about 5,000 kilometers. Now, you're probably, I hope you're thinking, wow, that's such a cool idea, a boat built out of recycled plastic. But you may also be thinking, okay, it's made out of recycled plastic. What does it have to do with this? Let me explain. Building the Flipflopi is part of our mission to go from our reality of today, as seen in the photo behind me, to our vision of tomorrow. We know that building one boat out of recycled plastic isn't going to empty the oceans of plastic forever. But it's the first step, and it's an alternative way to show what can be done with plastic. We want it to be a symbol for reducing plastic use and ultimately ending single-use plastic. Single-use plastic is most of this stuff. Anything that is considered disposable, such as plastic bags and water bottles, which are two of the biggest culprits. So what's special about a boat that gets built out of these things in the pictures behind me? I'll tell you my three favorite things. I know this infographic tells you a lot more, but I'll tell you my three favorite. The first is just the sheer size of the boat. From the bottom of the boat to the top of the sail will be the same as three giraffes standing on top of each other, which is massive. Secondly is the fact that every single part of this boat is really and truly built out of recycled plastic. So the sail is actually going to be made of a fabric which has been made from recycled plastic bags, which is not only waterproof, but hopefully pretty durable as well. And finally, the fact that our boat will have a crew of about 20 people sailing it all the way from Lamu to Cape Town. There will be a film crew making a documentary, marine conservationists, several expert sailors, a few beginning sailors, and hopefully no one like me who will be seasick the entire journey. So how have we built this boat? We're very lucky to have some excellent members of our team. First and foremost being Ali Skander, who is our chief dhow builder. His family has been in Lamu since the 1300s and are known for their intricate designs on Lamu wood. Him and his team are doing an incredible job of putting together the boat using traditional methods and a very unconventional substance, plastic. The way the boat gets built is very similar to the way an ice lolly is made. So if you can imagine the ice lolly mold, which you fill with liquid and then freeze overnight, the process is quite similar. The plastic gets collected, cleaned, and pretty much melted down before being poured into the mold, where it cools for quite a while and finally gets pulled out in the ready-made pieces. Once the pieces are ready, they're taken to Ali and his team for assembling and putting them together in the shape of the boat. So we're in the process of building it now, and it's very exciting to see the boat slowly but surely coming together. And we're very excited about this very unique and exciting opportunity. You're probably wondering why it's called the Flipflopi. One of the things that we're also doing is collecting 200,000 discarded flip-flops from around the Kenyan coast. And we're going to turn them into these amazing multicolored panels to cover the entire boat, so that our boat is going to look something like this. We've also chosen the flip-flop because they're fairly universal. Most people have seen, worn, used flip-flops. They know what they are, but they don't always know just how long-lasting they are and what a negative impact they've had on our oceans. So we want the Flipflopi to be a symbol that's not only fun, exciting, and colorful, but one that everybody can relate to, no matter where you are. So our boat is going to be roughly 60 feet long, made of about 15 tons of recycled plastic, and it's going to sail 5,000 kilometers. I hope that excites you as much as it excites me. There are other solutions that I mentioned, among them this hashtag plastic revolution. As you may have figured out by now, the team behind the Flipflopi is all a little bit crazy, but very, very passionate about this subject. And that's why we launched the plastic revolution in conjunction with the boat. The plastic revolution is a movement, and it's a movement to make real lasting change happen. We're doing this because we want to reduce, reuse, and recycle plastics, and start a new conversation around plastics as well, by uniting all the stakeholders in the conversation. And all of us are a part of this conversation, from me, to all of you in this room, to governments, to private companies, to communities. Every single one of us has a stake in this, because it all impacts our beautiful planet, and without our planet, we don't have a place for future generations. And finally, because, to paraphrase Mahatma Gandhi, we want to be the change we wish to see in the world. To that effect, I want to commend the Kenyan government, especially Professor Judy Wahungu, and activists such as James Wakiba, for driving a ban on plastic bags in Kenya, which is a first step in a long journey towards changing this. But, as we all know, the journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. So, you might not be a government official who can implement a law that will change how people use plastics in your country. You might not be a business leader who can decide to not use plastic in your manufacturing. But there are so many things that you can do on an individual basis to make a difference. For example, you can cut down using straws, because plastic straws are one of the worst things you can use, and they have the biggest impact on some of our animals. You can take a reusable water bottle with you wherever you go. If you go shopping, convince your parents or your friends and yourselves not to use plastic bags. Take a reusable one instead. If you see plastic anywhere around while you're out and about, pick it up so that it doesn't break down into those smaller pieces and get into the bodies of animals and humans. And if you do pick up plastic or see plastic, see if you can come up with a creative way to use it. There are lots of different things you can do. And finally, get involved. Do something. If the flip-floppy excites you, we'd always love for you to be a part of it, whether it's by donating your time, your money, your energy, getting involved in spreading awareness as well to help us in this cause. But you can do more than just that as well. You can create a recycling program in your school. You can set up a community cleanup. Do something. Do whatever floats your boat, but make sure you do something. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope we want to keep our beaches looking like this, the same way that I do. If we all take small steps together, we can make sure that not just our beaches, but the rest of our planet looks like this as well. I invite you to join us on this journey of the plastic revolution and be part of the Flipflopi. And thank you very much for your time.